small kids.
Mm-hmm.
And it's proven to be very efficient, because that's how, you know, well, everybody knows that's how school is being taught now. So right. I have a lot of experience in liaising with the teachers and catching up on work and stuff like that. So,
mm-hmm.
and for myself, I've been following along on my job as well, also using Zoom. It's very efficient for me thus far, as well as I could see.
Definitely. So thank you so much for that. Thank you so much for that.
You're welcome.
Well, Ms. Diaz, I know, well, you're part of the academy, correct?
Ms. Diaz was having some problems.
Oh, okay.
With her audio.
All right, not a problem. So it was just a quick little icebreaker to kind of get some idea as to where we're at. So I think we all have a fair idea of Zoom. Now, these are some objectives or learning outcomes that I set for this session, but I'll go through, I'm flexible enough to tweak as we go along and to cater to your needs in particular, because I didn't want to do just a generic thing. You know, I wanted to cater to your needs, because I think when I was briefed about this session, I was informed that you might be interested in knowing ways of how to engage your class and so on, correct?
Yes.
So what I will do is, even though we have these learning outcomes, these are some of the topics that we'll be looking at. You wouldn't need that, because from my understanding, I think you may not be creating your sessions, but you will be given a link, correct?
Yes.
Right, good. So what we'll do is probably just start from beginning a Zoom session. All right. So let me just change this PowerPoint. I'll stop sharing for now. And one of the first things I'll just bring your attention to is the layout of this particular interface. So you would see some buttons at the very bottom, and I'm going to change some privileges in just a bit. So you will see at the very bottom, can you see the participants list?
Yeah.
Right, so click on participants. And you will see all the persons who are present in your particular session. So let's say in your actual online sessions, you want to know who to take attendance, for example. This would be a quick way to get that information. All right, now, in addition to that, it's a good way, because part of engaging your students in this platform, you know, you might have to call them by name. You know, if they, you ever ask a question in an online environment, and then you just hear silence, or I know a colleague who will say tumbleweed or you know, crickets. You know, so this is one way of calling persons by name. So if it is you need. You ask a question, for example, let's say about some global trend or something relevant to your session, and you just hear silence, then, you know, you could call, for example, okay, you know, so-and-so, I see, you know, what do you think about X, Y, and Z, you know, and that way that student can now turn on their mic and answer the question or contribute to the class. So that's one. You really want to make sure you have this participants list available. The other thing I'm going to show you, well, of course, you already know to turn on your cameras and so on. Now, in your sessions, you may not have to turn on. Let me turn on mine, by the way. In your sessions, you may not have to turn on your cameras, but just make sure. Okay, there we go. You may not have to turn on your cameras, but sorry, you can turn on your cameras, but you don't have to make it mandatory for your students to turn on their cameras. Why? Because, well, you could tell me why do you think I would suggest that?
The bandwidth issue?
There you go. So bandwidth will be an issue. So you really want to make it a smooth smooth experience for them, because they may not have the best internet quality. And so, you know, you don't want that it's a disruptive experience for them, or they miss things that are taking place and so on. So you definitely want to be mindful of that. The other thing I'm going to show you now with regard to participants is I'm skipping a bit because, you know, I have an idea now that you know some of the general basic things about Zoom. One of the things that you want to be mindful of is the privileges in Zoom. Now, you could make your participants co-hosts, but you definitely don't want to make them hosts. Why? Because the hosts can do anything in a particular session. Now, the host, just so you know, the hosts, you can only have one host per session. So that host should always be you. All right? Should always be you. So you don't want to give anybody else hosting privileges. What you want to do is give them co-hosting privileges. So in the event that, let's say, do you have, for example, instances where you would want your students to present?
Mm-hmm.
Right. So this is one instance where you would want to make them a co-host so they can share their screen. So I'm going to do two things in one here. First, I'm going to show you how to switch or change privileges in Zoom for your students. And then I'm going to show you how to share your screen. All right. So the first thing you want to do, you already have the participants list, and you should see it, I think, at the side of your screen for the most part. When you hover over someone's name, you will see an icon stating more. You will see mute and more if the microphone is on. If it's so what I want you to do is click on more. Now I'm gonna do it for Ms. Guy first. And when I click on more, I'm gonna make you a co-host, all right? So Ms. Guy, I'll ask you now to make Ms. Marchand a co-host, all right? So you just, in the participants list, you hover over her name and you will see more,
mm-hmm.
Right? And then you just click make co-host.
It doesn't come up.
It doesn't come up?
No, when I go to more,
okay,
I get chat stuff video pin.
Mm-hmm.
Spotlight for everyone, rename.
All right. Allowed. Okay. I think that's because you wouldn't. So let me make you the host.
I'm a host.
Yeah, let me make you the host. So I'll make you a host. All right. And good. So try it one more time, please. Good. Right.
So only the host can make co-host.
Correct. Because the host is like the teacher. That's you. Mm-hmm. All right.
So,
and the reason for that, you don't want to make your students the host because you don't want your session to be hijacked, right? So you are the one driving the ship, as they say, or driving the car. So, and the students are the passengers, so to speak. So you want to make sure that you remain the host and they remain the co-host, right? So I'm showing you this so you know how to do it. So what I'm gonna do, Ms. Guy, could you make Ms. Marchand the host now using the same procedure? There you go, excellent. So, right, so Ms. Marchand, you are now made into the host. You are now made the host of the session. So what I need you to do is to make Ms. Modest a co-host, please. So you just hover over her name and you're gonna see more. Then you click on more and make host.
Make host or co-host?
Well, in this case, in your teaching context, you'll make it co-host, but in this context, we make it
host.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Good. Excellent. So, Ms. Modest, could you make Ms. Diaz the host? So, you're all getting, and that's a beauty when you have a small class. Yeah? So, it's the same procedure. Right. Good. Right. So, a natural at it. And Ms. Diaz, could you make me the host now, please?
Okay.
you're still the host, Ms. Diaz. Just hover over my name and you're gonna see more and you just click make host. There you go. So good, so everyone got a chance to make. Now, like I said, you're gonna have two different options, one to make a co-host, one to make host. In your actual teaching context, when you are teaching your classes, you need to remain the host, all right? Because you are the teacher or the driver of the vehicle. The students can be made into co-hosts. Now think of it like this. You have a car, you are the driver, AKA the teacher, AKA the host, and you would like to make, let's say, you know, you bring children from the back seat into the passenger seat. You know, that's promotion there, quote unquote. Mm-hmm. So by making students the co-hosts, they are sort of, you make them into your, you promoted them into the passenger seat. So once you're a co-host, that means you can do certain things in this, in the Zoom sessions. You can, mute microphones or unmute microphones. You can share your screen, which is the most important thing that I'm gonna show you now, all right? So let's say if a student has to do a presentation and they have a PowerPoint presentation or some sort of case study or something that they need to share, this is how you're gonna make that happen. So before we go there, any questions on changing permissions or rules in Zoom so far? Would you like me to do it again?
I just wanted to ask, mm-hmm. So for example, when they have to do presentations and they have to be made the co-host in order to do that.
Right.
When the particular student is finished, do you then remove the co-host?
Yes.
Finish before the next speaker comes up?
Correct. In fact, it depends on how the session is set up. Most persons cannot share their screens at the same time. Zoom wouldn't allow for that. So it would help that if you make someone else a co-host and you, how to say this in a diplomatic way, I'm talking to the right people here. You remove the co-host privileges from the previous person, all right? So you could have multiple co-hosts in your class. I would recommend that you just do one at a time so you can manage it, all right? So persons wouldn't be bumping off each other's presentations and it becomes chaotic, all right? So let's say if you have person X who has to present now and they have a PowerPoint to accompany their presentation, then you make that person a co-host, person X, and when person X is finished presenting, you can make person Y a co-host, all right? And remove the co-host privileges from person X, all right? And that way it minimizes the potential for disruptions, you know, because sometimes persons could click things accidentally and then it throws off everything and time is taken for that. So, all right? Any other questions on that so far? Let's plug this in. All right, so what I'm gonna do is show you very quickly how to share your screen. I think you might have some experience in that, but just so you know. All right, so let me make, I'm just going with the top of my list, but in this case, I'll start at the bottom and then we'll go from there. So I'll go to Miss Modest. I'm gonna make you a co-host. Now, all co-hosts, like I said, can have the potential or the privileges to share their screens, whether it be a PowerPoint, an Excel spreadsheet, a video even. They can, once you give them that privilege, co-host privilege, then they can do that. So Ms. Modest is a co-host now. So Ms. Modest, what you will see is a green button at the bottom of your screen. Usually at the bottom of your screen, sometimes it's at the top. Can you see that? It share screen?
Yes, I am.
Right.
Yes, I am.
So once you click on that, you will see a window pop up with all the windows that you have open, whether it's in Google or whatever browsers you have open, a document of some sort. Maybe I should have asked you to to open up a document that you might want to share. It could be a simple PowerPoint or just anything for that matter. And then click on share screen. So close off that window, that pop-up window.
Okay.
And you can open a document that that you don't mind sharing with us. Please. All right. So once you have that document, you will see, you can go ahead and click on the share screen button again.
Yeah, I have done that.
Okay, good. So you will see some window, you'll see it's a pop-up window that will appear, and you will, so you select any of those windows, those blocks inside there, any particular document that you would like to share. So you click on it and then click share.
Share.
There you go. All right, excellent, excellent. So this is how you share a document. Now, let's say you have a video that you wanted to share, and I'll go through with everybody else as well. In a case where you have a video, you would see at the bottom of that window, that pop-up window, you would see something share audio. So let's say you want to stop sharing this screen. You would see a button at the top. When you just push your cursor all the way to the top, you should see a menu, and it will ask if you want to stop sharing.
Press stop share.
Yes. Excellent. So let's do it one more time. So click on share screen. And you will see, not yet. So stop sharing.
Stop share. Okay.
All right. And I want you to click on the share screen button one more time. Just the share screen button. And you're going to see when that pop-up window comes up, you're going to see on the left side, share sound and optimize video clip.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So if you were going to share a video, then you would probably need to click on those two buttons.
Yes.
Yeah. So it makes your video, so persons could hear what's going on in your video.
Okay.
Right. So let's say if you pull up a YouTube video or some video somewhere that you got from somewhere, that you don't want to just share the link in the chat, you might want to actually share from your device, then that's a way to do it. You just click share sound and or optimize for video clip, and then you click share.
Okay.
All right.
Okay, understood.
Great. Let's go to, let me make Ms. Bachchan, I'll make you a co-host. So I'm gonna walk you through the same procedure, yeah? So what you're gonna do is click on that green screen. That green button. I'm watching it, the label says share screen and I'm trying to say green. So it's, so click on share screen.
Right.
And you will see that pop-up window. You will see at the lower left of that window, you will see share sound and optimize for video clip, correct?
Right, yeah.
So if you wanted to share a video, then, you know, and enable the sound and audio and so on, you click on that. If it's just a normal document, you don't have to click that. All right. So what I need you to do is click on any document or any window that you see presented in that pop-up window. And you're going to click share right after that.
Anything that came up here?
Yes. Yes. So one of the things while you do, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. Just see, and just say share.
And just click share. And there you go.
Okay, yeah, it was whiteboard, I think, that came up.
Right, yes.
Yeah.
So that's how you share a document, a video presentation, or whatever you have. So let's try it one more time. All right, so you can click at the top, you would just place the cursor all the way to the top of the screen. You're going to see a menu to stop sharing.
Stop. Oh, right. Okay.
Right.
Right.
And you're going to try it one more time. All right. Because I believe practice makes
Right.
Say yeah, permanent, correct. But you know.
Okay, so this was the share.
Right.
And then I could have just clicked here.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and then click share.
And then click share.
Right.
There you go.
Right.
All right.
So that came up with a whiteboard. And then when I'm ready to exit, I click stop share.
Correct. That's exactly it. All right. Excellent. So, Ms. Guy, sorry to keep you in suspense. So I'm making you co-host as well. And so you're going to go through this process. So once you have a document or a window that you need to share, you mm-hmm. click on the share screen button.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Once you see that, if you have a video of some sort, then you, of course, you'll see the at the lower left side, you're going to see the two buttons to enable audio and that sort of thing. All right. And then you just click on any window that appears, that little any tile that appears in that pop-up window that you think is worth sharing. And then you you click share.
Well,
mm-hmm.
I clicked share and a number of open windows came up.
Right, good. That's perfectly
good. But when I clicked on the window that I wanted to share,
mm-hmm.
and I went back to share screen.
Right.
It isn't happening.
All right, so let's try it from scratch again. So,
okay, let me close.
Yeah.
So, share screen.
Right, so click on share screen, and then you're gonna see the pop-up window appear.
Yeah.
And then you just click on any tile that you deem worthy to share.
Yes, it goes blue.
Right, exactly. Good. So you click on that tile.
Uh-huh.
And then you click share.
Okay, you know what I was doing, not listening to you. I was going back to share screen and clicking share.
That's perfectly fine, right? So good. So we have our document here. All right, and so you are able to share your screen. So to stop sharing, you just hover all the way to the top and you'll see, there you go. Very good, very good. Excellent. I think Ms. Diaz says you're hearing, but no one seems to be hearing me, so. All right, that's okay, Ms. Diaz. Once you can hear us, and I guess you could just type in the chat and we'll communicate. All right, so it'll be a written communication arrangement just for you. All right, so Ms. Diaz, so you would need to try this as well. So I'm gonna make you a co-host. All right, and it's the same procedure. You can click on the share screen button at the bottom of your screen. You're gonna see a pop-up. Very good. Let's see, you're gonna share something now. Okay, good. It's good. Taking a little while, but that's all right. It will come up. There we go. So it just came up on my end. So good. So we have this document that came up here. All right. Excellent. So to stop sharing, you're just going to place it. Nice. Good. Oh, you're a quick one. All right. So great. So we have that experience now. Just to kind of give a little check where we're at. We now know how to change privileges within a particular Zoom session. And that's, of course, for student engagement purposes. So they can be more at the front and center of the teaching and learning process. And then we also looked at how to share screen. So that goes for both you and all your students. when you might have a PowerPoint to accompany your particular session. If not, you might have a video you might want to show them. So this would work in those situations. Yeah? So the next thing I want to show you, and I think you already know this, is the chat. You already know the chat, but let's say you wanted to message someone privately. You can configure your chat in such a way that it doesn't have to go to everybody, but it can just go to one person, all right? So to do that, again, you could hover over the person's name. You're gonna see more. You're gonna see more. And you can, you're just gonna see chat. It should be at the top of the person's on that list. And you can chat with that person directly. And when it says directly, meaning directly with that person, not to everyone. So I'll send a message to Miss Marchand, for example. And Miss Marchand, you should see my message now. I'll send a message to Miss Guy. And I'll send, so everyone should get a direct message or personal message or private message. Right, Ms. Dears, you know this, right. So good. And so you can reply accordingly as well. Now, one of the things you wanna be mindful that when you want to revert to chatting with everybody, let's say you wanna put an announcement or a link in the chat for the entire class to see, you want to make sure that you set it back to everyone. Yeah, there you go. So everyone will see the chat, all right? And that's right at the top of the chat inbox there. You tap the type box. You just click back everyone in meeting, all right? So where you would see the person's name, let's say Miss Marchand, if it is that you and I were chatting privately or directly, then you want to set it back to everyone. You would see right where you see two, just above the text box. So you click on two and you'll see a drop-down menu to chat with specific persons or to everyone in a meeting. So you can chat directly. Yeah, you can chat directly via clicking on the person's name and going to more, or you can do it just above the text box. The reason I do it using the participants list is because if you have a session that has a lot of people in it, you're gonna have to scroll through and it could be a little bit confusing. So I prefer just to go to the top where I can see it a little more easily and you're good to go there, all right? So we have that, we looked at, looking at the participants list, we looked at changing privileges or roles in a Zoom session. We also looked at sharing your screen. We looked at using the chat feature. Now, another thing that you want to probably use is, let me just see if I have it here. Yes, I'm still the host, okay, just making sure. you have a couple different things that you can use. You have reactions. So you would see at the very end of your screen or bottom of your screen, you would see reactions. And I'm going through this just before going back to my PowerPoint. All right. So you would see reactions. And this is if you want, well, you are the teacher, so you wouldn't have to raise your hand per se, but you might want to give students some, I'll give my example, right? When I'm doing online sessions and I have students I put them into groups for them to present, for example, sometimes I give comments in the chat and then I use emojis as well. Or you could, just show that you are your sentiments on a particular thing without having to type a whole sentence. So when you see reactions there, and let's say if I click on, when you click on reactions, you're gonna see a couple different reactions that you can have. All right. Right. So Miss Kai is laughing. All right. And Miss Marchand, Miss Modest, right, Miss Diaz, you have your thumbs up. All right. So it's a very quick way of saying that you agree or disagree or stating how you feel about something. And yes, Miss Modest, yes, weaving. Now, one of the things that you wanted to use this more directly in a teaching and learning context or for teaching points, you might want to use this to show, for students to show agreement on a particular topic or issue. Let's say you were to ask a question and you don't want to do a long poll and all this sort of thing. You just want quick feedback on a particular topic or issue. Let's say something along the lines of, do you agree with the vaccination drive in a particular territory? All right. Or do you agree with the, do you think that, I know I'm going to something controversial here. Do you think that making the vaccination mandatory is an attack on human rights? Right. I'm just trying to find something relevant to your field. So excuse me. Right. So you might want to ask that question to students and they can state their reactions. All right. Their reactions may be a thumbs up. Their reactions may be a sad face, a sad emoji, or even a vex emoji like what I have here, right? I'm just giving examples. So this is a fun way of getting their input and their feedback on general issues or trends in the world and in your field, yeah? So that's one way of doing that. So I just wanted to show you the reactions because sometimes it's easier just for them to click on an emoji than to type out a whole sentence because not everybody is a quick typer. All right. Any questions so far? So far, so good?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So I'm just showing you here what you want to do when as a quick recap. So when you're joining a Zoom meeting, especially if it's on a new device, for example, they're gonna give you some initial prompts with regard to checking your audio, you know, that sort of thing. And even if you want the session to be recorded. Now, if you want the session to be recorded, you would see a button to record at the bottom of the screen, as you see in this graphic here. You'd have to click it now because I don't want you to lose this recording, but it's just a quick way of being able to record your session. And that helps, of course, for students for reviewing purposes, revision purposes. All right, so I just wanted to show you where the record button is set. And even if you need to leave a meeting, of course, you see at the very end there how to end the meeting or how to leave the meeting. All right, so I just wanted to, I know you might be familiar with it because you have used Zoom fairly extensively or frequently. So I just wanted to show that. Now, one of the benefits with recordings in Zoom is that you could pause at any particular time and resume the recording. So I'm pretty sure, I'm just asking, do any of you have instances where you might be having a discussion on some not personal, but sensitive issues that you may not want to have recorded? Mm-hmm. Right. So in a case like that, even though you are recording the session, you can, as a host, you can pause the recording. Right? Let's say you want to pause the recording to talk about a particular issue that you don't want recorded. You know, if something happened that you don't want a part of the recording for others to see, then you could pause the recording at any particular time. All right? And you see the buttons there as well. So just as you could stop the recording, you could pause the recording. All right? And I showed you this already, how to you know, when you go to a person's name and you go to more and so on. So I'm just trying to recap as we go along. So we did all of this already. And now we also went into engagement. So what I'm gonna do is, we did this part. So there are different ways you can engage your students. In addition to using the chat feature, the share screen feature, the reactions or emojis. You can also use different avenues. So you have the breakout rooms, which we'll get to in just a bit. Polls, which you don't have to use polls because the reaction sort of function as quick polls without you having to type a question. But you definitely want to consider annotations. Now, annotations is a good way to get students to type on a particular slide. So I'm trying to find a clear slide that would allow you to, okay, well, let me just go and put, one sec. You know what, this would be good practice. So Ms. Marchand, do you want to share, you just had a blank slide just now, correct?
Yes.
All right, so do you want to share that one more time, please?
That would be share screen.
Right, good. This is a good, see, so it's a good question for you.
I'm just seeing your screen.
Right, that's all right. As soon as you share, you click share screen, it should stop mine from sharing. Yeah. Right, I can stop sharing just so you get.
Okay, right. So this is what I had. And then that was what I had before.
Great. So keep it on this. Keep it on this. Now, what I'm going to invite you, everyone, to do is to annotate on this particular canvas. Let's call it that for now. So to do that, you're going to see it's usually either at the top or at the bottom of your screen. You're going to see view options. Yeah? View options, and then you click annotate. And once you click annotate, so you're already seeing Ms. Marchand's pen moving around, but you will also see mine as well. I'm not sure if you're seeing it yet, but by default, it's set to like a pencil, but you might want to click T for text. So you're gonna see a little, once you click annotate, right? So Ms. Guy inserted hers, good. And then you just type. And as soon as you click that, now you could, you know, if you have a list of things you want to type, you could put that there. Good, so we have that. So go ahead now and type your name anywhere on this particular slide.
Okay.
So if you want to change from the pencil, you could just click on T for text. Something's wrong, Ms. Marchand?
Yeah, mine isn't
Right, so in your case, you should see either at the top of your screen or at the bottom of your screen, you're gonna see view options.
View options.
If you hover all the way to the top, for example. All right, Ms. Modest, very good, very good. If you're not seeing it at the top, you might see it at the bottom of your screen when you go all the way to the top or all the way to the bottom. All right, Ms. Diaz, good, good. All right, Ms. Guy. The quick brown fox game, okay. Nice, very good, very good. I like what I'm seeing. And you could even draw, as you see someone drew there. If you wanted to draw something or emphasize something, you could insert, you know, an arrow if you'd like, different shapes and so on. Right? There we go. So if you wanted to, let's say you have a diagram or some sort of illustration that you want to, you know, students to observe, and you highlight certain things in there, this is a good way to emphasize that. Yeah? Ms. Bachchan, you found the text button or no?
No, I'm not seeing it at all.
All right, so.
It's a T on the top.
Yeah. Are you seeing the view options icon or no?
What exactly does that look like?
Right, so I shouldn't say icon. It's just, you'll see the word. It's, so if I were to come off of this part, you should see next to your, well, in my case, you are viewing Jennifer Marchand's screen, mm-hmm. and I will see view options.
Next to it.
Yeah, next to it. And when I click view options, I can click annotate. In your case, it may very well be at the bottom of the screen, if not at the top.
Mm.
No? All right, so let me share my screen now. And I'll give you, so you should see something a little different now. So I'm sharing my screen. So you should see at the top of your screen, you are viewing Justin Zephyrin's screen. So hover all the way to the top, move the cursor all the way to the top. Mm-hmm. And then you
right,
and you see view options.
Oh, I'm seeing view options, yeah. Right. Yeah, I'm seeing that.
And that way you can, you just click view options and then you see annotations.
Oh, okay. Okay, now, I'm seeing it.
Right. When you were sharing just now, it would look a little different because you would see, for example, correct me if I'm wrong, you would see something along the lines of a floating menu at the top of your screen.
Yes, that's what right. I was saying.
So I forgot to tell you that. That's my fault. You would see more. So let me stop sharing and you can share now so you see what it looks like. So you could go ahead and share that, the canvas you had. Right. And if you go, you hover all the way to the top of the screen, you're gonna see the menu and the dotted line, the ellipsis on the right side.
Mm-hmm, but right. More?
Oh. Exactly, more. So you click more.
Right.
And right, then you'll see
retracted. You. I don't know why. I don't know why it retracted.
Yeah, but if that happens, just keep placing it, just move the cursor around.
Okay, around and it will come back.
Yeah, yeah.
Ah, okay.
It's so like a floating, yeah, it's like a floating menu.
Okay, and when that comes down, I need to look for.
Right, oh. Mm-hmm. You see the ellipsis or the dotted lines, the dots at the end of the, on the right side of that menu, and then you click annotations or annotate.
But actually, this has disabled annotation for others and hide names of annotators. It doesn't have annotate.
So you're not seeing annotate?
No.
Hmm. Very I wonder strange. If it's because you're the co-host and not the host. But it could be that for that reason. But it's the same procedure.
Okay.
All right?
Okay.
So definitely, you can see that there. So annotations is another way to engage a student. So if you have, for example, like I said, a graphic. So let's say I wanted you to draw, to place an arrow on a particular, let's pretend this was all part of a process. Mm-hmm. And I want you now as a student to highlight something in this process, just so you know, to verify that you know what I'm talking about and that you know what you need to know. I would simply do the same thing. So annotate or annotations and just insert an arrow or you know, something of that sort, or shape, or, you know. So let's see if I wanted to place a circle around this. I can do that. Good. And look, Miss Guy did the same thing. So good. So it's a good way to highlight any particular right copy URL. Yes. So it's a good way. What I do is when I show illustrations, I like to show illustrations to students without the, without the labels. So I have them insert the labels, and that way you know that they understand, you know, if, for example, a policy making process, you might probably need to cover with them, and they have to you might want them to elaborate on the, or identify the different stages in a policy, approved policy. They could go through, they could insert the labels along the processes, within the process, sorry. They could insert the labels or the steps within the process. Sorry, that's what I'm trying to say. All right. So let me just close this off. Now you could clear the formatting at any particular time if you are the host, because you're gonna see, so for example, Miss Gaia make you a host. And you will see when you, with that menu at the top, you will see a dustbin that says clear all annotations or clear all drawings and so on.
Oh Lord, sorry.
That's all right. So if you were to draw on this particular, slide here, so I'm just gonna put something for you to clear. All right. And you should see like a floating, the same annotation menu.
Listen, I have lost you.
Oh, okay, I'm seeing the Zoom join a meeting on your screen. So let me.
Yes.
I think it might be.
And on the other side, it says meeting controls.
All right, well, let me just help you in terms of, happy to stop sharing and then. Oh, you are the host, so I can.
Do you want me to leave the meeting?
No, could you make, are you seeing the,